my page, github.com/lupyuen. I'm not sure you can see that. Lup Yuen is spelled L-U-P-Y-U-E-N. You see this thing on top called IoT Mission. Click it, and you see that big slide, okay? While you're doing that, I'll just pass this toy around. So it's quite interesting. So this is actually what I kind of figure out. I spent 1 year whole to figure out that this is really the best thing that we should do for learning IoT, you know, using modern controllers like this, an NRF52 by Nordic Semiconductor, okay? The way it's configured is quite interesting here because this is actually running a Bluetooth mesh. So if anybody got a power bank, you can actually plug this to a power bank, this thing will all come on. Then there are buttons here on each of these gadgets, right? So when you press the button, all the lights will turn on and all that turn off, okay? So let me assure you that it's not talking through the wires. Wires only for wires only for charging, but it's actually using Bluetooth mesh to communicate, simulating like a central light switch kind of thing. Okay, so I just pass this around. Let's have fun. Okay, so everybody there, github.com/lupyuen. Click on IoT Mission, and you see this huge diagram. Okay, so everything I talk about it. Okay, all my talking points are actually all in this thing, which has a lot of links, articles. Okay, so which you can read in spare time. But today I'll just talk about this guy here. Right. Whew. Okay, let's go and expand this. Download. Yeah. Okay, good. Right. Okay, so my name is Lup Yuen. So I teach IoT. Okay. I was teaching IoT at Temasek Poly actually. This is an adult course for IoT learners. So people like you, okay? If you're interested to learn how to, you know, do IoT, create IoT products, okay, or learn how to apply IoT, you know, come attend my course. I used to be teaching at TP until the demand kind of dropped, so I decided to take a break and just do things. Okay, I need to take time off to do things because I see a lot of problems in the whole ecosystem. Firstly, IoT is really, really complex. Okay, there's a lot of stuff in here. I'm quite happy that I've got the skills in actually all of these that I built up over 5 years. Yes, you got to start with your microcontroller. Like for example, Arduino is one kind of microcontroller that we all use. The one that's going around with Nordic NRF52, another type. We've got sensors, right? So we've got sensors to monitor your temperature, monitor motion, all kinds of things, right? You need to worry about how you manage your microcontroller using a real-time operating system, right? You need to worry about transceivers. Once you get all data, you must go to a network, right, or some sort. So how are you going to send this to a network and massage the data? Then, of course, the big thing on top, your IoT network. Which network are you going to use? Okay, there are a few options now. And then later on, you go into the IoT cloud. So clouds to process the data. And this big space in the center, there's the software part, the programming part. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done in the programming aspect also. It's not that easy to write code for a software gadget. So let me just explain what's going on here. So, okay, let's start, let's say on the right side, okay? Now, the thing is that here we have the IoT cloud, okay? The good news about IoT cloud is that everything is all mature. You heard of Amazon Web Services, AWS. They have their IoT offering. It's very mature, yes. If you want to use it, go ahead and use it. But just warn you that AWS nowadays is an expensive premium cloud. So if you're prepared to pay for it, you know, go ahead and use it. There are cheaper options. So options that are talking about article. For example, we've got the things like the Things.io. Okay, the Things.io is actually a more focused cloud, which is focused just for IoT. What it does is that it allows you to hook up devices like the ones that are passing around or Arduino very easily. It got nice dashboards. If you need to do any coding in the cloud, you know, similar to AWS Lambda functions, you can do that. They've got simple JavaScript support in the cloud, so it helps, right? Then of course, we've got other kinds of clouds. Like for example, I also use Google Cloud. Google Cloud is great because among the three big cloud providers, Amazon, Azure, Google is probably the cheapest among all three. So it's a good option if you think that you want something as big as Amazon, but you can't afford it, try Google. Then, of course, there's the China option. I also tried Alibaba Cloud, okay? So don't discount it, it's actually quite good. You may think that it looks a bit like AWS, yes it does, but it actually works quite well. And there's a very strong reason to use that. If your gadget needs to work in China, I think you should use Alibaba Cloud because chances are the other clouds are all blocked. Your Amazon, your Google, and your Azure. So might as well just use Alibaba Cloud. It's probably the best choice for them. And it's actually quite stable. There are also other options you can choose. In my article, I talk about Grafana. If you haven't seen it, Grafana, you should take a look. It's quite good. Grafana, G-R-A-F-A-N-A. It's open source toolkit. So it's not a web service, but you can install it. It's written in Go, it's very fast, it creates very good dashboards. Okay, it used to be for enterprise, now it's also, I think it's also good for IoT. The other thing that you like a lot is also this software called Prometheus. You know the movie Prometheus? Okay, so this is about the time series database. Time series database, okay, you might not realize now, but you need it for IoT. Time series database means that I can make a query like, what is average temperature every day for the past month? Okay, this kind of queries, you can run on regular SQL database, but you eventually run the problems because SQL doesn't really treat time sequence data any specially. Whereas time series database like Prometheus does that. So these kind of queries will simply run very fast. So you should consider a time series database if you're doing any kind of serious IoT work, right? Okay. So beyond that, you have all the stuff on the right side. Analytics, visualization, machine learning, everything is all there, okay? So good news is that it all works. I've been a former enterprise architect at NCS. I know that all this enterprise stuff works, and also it also works for IoT, right? So therefore, there's no problem here, okay? So let's try and move one step back and see whether this whole thing, I call it IoT chain, okay? And these are all the individual links, okay? So there must be some reason why we are creating all these expensive gadgets that really don't solve any kind of problems, okay? Why are we creating such gadgets that no one wants to use? So let's find what's wrong with all these links. We confirmed that the IoT cloud is fine. I've done lots of investigation on that. Next part is the network. Okay, network is a bit tricky. So when I started first with teaching IoT, I was using the Sigfox network. So Sigfox, in case you haven't heard, is actually running on license-free bands in Singapore, available nationwide. Okay, but it's got very few messages per day. Like recommended is 140 messages per day. Message size is also very small. It's 12 bytes per message. Very small messages, very infrequent messages, right? But it's really cheap. So the charges are like a few dollars per device per year. Okay, so you can't get any better than that, right? So when I was teaching at TP, we actually used that for student projects. It was quite fun. We created lots of interesting things with it. My students even created this AED monitoring. You know those AED devices where people collapse, you revive them? Those devices are not monitored. So why don't we just put in an AED monitoring device on these devices, alert somebody when these things fail the downsticks or the power drains. You know the AED monitors can actually have the drain power. All it does today is that it just beeps and hope that somebody will go in and fix it. But nobody will do that, right? So this was a very good idea. Unfortunately, we kind of got stuck because Sigfox, even though in theory it's a good network, we find it very hard to commercialize. Firstly, it's actually quite expensive to create a new gadget out of Sigfox. The modules themselves will be quite cheap, but eventually you need to go into PCB manufacturing, putting a microcontroller and all that. The costs add up. Then the other big problem is that Sigfox doesn't run in China. So a lot of the concepts are very alien. They don't know what Sigfox is. They don't know where to source it. I've got an article here where I tried to make my own hardware. It was very hard. It was very hard to make actually any Sigfox hardware in China. Okay. Just to warn you also, Sigfox, there was a lot of resistance. For some reason, government agencies and even companies didn't want to try Sigfox, even on a trial basis. For some reason, they think that Sigfox is a non-standard technology. So therefore, it's not endorsed by government, therefore they shouldn't use it. Okay, so it's kind of tough. Okay. So they were all waiting for NBRT, which is good because NBRT finally came out, right? NBRT, so today it's actually available through Singtel, M1 and StarHub, okay? So the telcos actually didn't provide a lot of documentation, but I actually put in some documents on that, so you can actually see how to hook up the NBRT devices and all that, right? Let me see about this. So the next part is that besides that, we've got the transceivers. So we've got issues, okay, the network, yes, NBRT is here. Let's go ahead and use it, right? Since it's official standard network, right? You've got three telcos you choose from, StarHub and one Singtel, right? Now, the problem is that the hardware aspect also comes into play. There's something interesting that we learned in IoT business over the past couple of years. We call it the MOQ problem. MOQ stands for minimum order quantity. What that means is that every time we approach a startup or hardware maker, okay, we say, we want to buy your gadget. Then they will always ask us, what is your minimum order quantity, MOQ? So it's a very common thing that we always hear. And we come to realize that if you need to ask MOQ, it's probably a big problem because it means that your device can only be affordable when you make it in huge quantity. And low quantity is just too expensive. So not quite right. So we got to fix that, right? So, throughout the years, I see that only way to make this work is that try not to create your new hardware. If you have any existing hardware, just reuse it. In the case of NBRT, it's actually quite good because NBRT, you find that it's actually really cheap. Okay, I'm going to pass on some more kits on here. Over here, okay, fine, I'll just pass this guy here. This speaker is quite fun. This guy here is actually MBLT board, okay? You see an MBLT module here. It's got a built-in GPS, okay? And the GPS antenna is here. And it's also got a built-in STM32L476 microcontroller. Everything all in one. And it's only $80. It is Sing dollars, okay? So these things are all dirt cheap. So everything is happening so fast and it's all cheap because China runs MBLT. So, you know, you can just simply, buy this off the shelf, right? So comparing MBLT with Sigfox, that this MBLT is definitely a better option. Everything's available off the shelf, just buy and use it, right? Maybe I'll pass up the other one. This thing is a simple option. So makers, you know, like all of us, we like something more modular. So this thing here is a breakout board for MBLT. So just simply plug it into your Arduino, your STM32, whatever, and it just works, right? There's a slot behind, it's like see a SIM card. So actually, these two are interchangeable. In case you don't like the right band, you can actually swap, right? So MBLT is actually a good network to use, right? So you can actually consider that. Maybe I'll just do a short intro. My friend here, Bing Chuan, is actually from StarHub, okay? But please, he's not here official business on StarHub. He's not here to present anything. He's just my friend, okay? So don't bother him with all kinds of funny questions, okay? One thing, do not ask your free SIM card, okay? No. Okay, so seriously, let me explain the situation why. If any telcos were to give out free SIM cards, there's no guarantee that we'll be loyal to them. So what is the incentive of giving you free SIM cards? So even if you were to buy a bunch of SIM cards or so, they think that SIM cards is a very low value business because MBLT is so cheap. So they need something more high value, okay? So I'm not sure what we can do about this, okay, because we're kind of stuck. We've got very good hardware coming from China. We've got no SIM cards to use it because telcos understand their business problem. So what can we do? I mean, is there something that we can work out as a trade between the whole hackerspace group and one of the telcos or something? So I hope you understand that this is what the situation is and this is why they do not give free SIM cards, okay? But if we can work something together, let's do it, okay? Because I think individual makers is tough, but as a group, we can do something, okay? Okay, next, let's move on to sensors. So sensors, yes, we've got lots of sensors, you know, all kinds of sensors around. We talk about I2C, SPI and all that. Arduino world, no problem. You can get all these things off the web. Everything's all there, right? But when you move into newer kinds of operating systems, you've got a problem, right? Where do you get drivers? So eventually, I just chose to use an open source operating system. It's called Apache Minute, M-Y-N-U-T-W-T, the sea lizard here. Yeah. So that's actually an open source operating system. It's got lots of drivers. So I just used it, and it's got pretty good support. So problem solved. So when you decide to move a new hardware platform, just remember, you know, how are you going to get your drivers? Because I don't think you want to code all your drivers from scratch. It's going to be quite painful. Next part I thought about is the RTOS, the real-time operating system, right? Eventually, you need to do some multitasking. You need to read the sensors, read multiple sensors, and you need to send data to a network. All these things need to handle concurrently. You cannot just stop one and do the rest, right? So eventually, you need multitasking. So why not just use a proper RTOS, right? Free RTOS, you can use that, yes, but it's quite old-fashioned now, and I don't like the way it was built. It's kind of really old-fashioned. So there are newer ones. Minute is actually a good new one. It's quite slim, it's quite small. Compared to Linux, it's actually a lot slimmer, smaller. Another one that's good is called Zephyr, Z-E-P-H-Y-R. So take a look at that also. Zephyr is good because it's supported actually by the main microcontroller makers. STMicro, NXP, Nordic Semiconductor, they all support Zephyr. So you can assure good support. But I kind of like systems that are a bit more flexible, that I can go and tweak myself. So that's why I'm still good with Minute. Okay, the second last part which I'm very passionate about is about microcontrollers, okay? So maybe I just ask everybody, please don't use Arduino anymore. Arduino is a dead end, okay? I mean, I taught Arduino, yes, then I realized it's a mistake because once you go Arduino, how can you commercialize with it? Nobody creates real things based on Arduino, okay? And also, Arduino is just simply unrealistic. People end up writing code that does bit banging. You know, instead of calling, to talk to SPI device or I2C device, you spend one bit at a time and then you loop. What the heck is that? It's not correct because you cannot do multitasking. You're busy looping around. Well, how can you do anything else while it's busy setting up bits? The right thing to do is to switch to a proper microcontroller, like Blue Pill. Okay, I'm going to pass it around. So Blue Pill is this STM32F103. This Blue Pill device is really cheap. cost Singapore dollars $3. Okay, so
about 15
yeah, exactly. It's not cheap. The funny thing is that the microcontroller is like IC Micro, but the whole dev board itself is actually China made. So it's quite long, interesting story about it. And over here, I connected to NBLT module, the Quectel module. So this thing actually runs as a IoT device all by its own, right? Let's pass it along. So this is actually a better option because you got all the proper APIs available, SPI, I2C, everything, all in there. So why not just use that instead? Problem is that it doesn't have that much good support from the maker, STMicro. These things are, STMicro only handles large enterprise customers. These things are meant to go into all your appliances and all that. They are not meant to go for dev kits. So therefore, STMicro will not care about learners. They won't care about people like us. Okay? So I had to go and dig out all the documentation and figure out what's the right way to do it, open source way, using Visual Studio Code, using all the modern tools and all that. So check my links for the documents. You'll find that it's actually quite nice to use. It's just that it took us a while to figure out because these things are really commercial. People working commercial will not want to share their secrets, but then we need to learn these things because these are real world microcontrollers that we should use. Okay, so if anything you should remember, just don't stop, please stop using Arduino. Use a decent microcontroller, STM32, okay, you won't regret it. Because otherwise you'll be stuck at the end. Okay, STM32 is fine, or the one I just passed around, the Nordic NRF52. Those are fine also, because they are really ARM-based microcontrollers. Okay, so I'll just spend a bit more time. Embedded programming. So that's my last part here. I put it right in the center because I realized from my teaching experience, it's really quite bad. Firstly, do I really expect all my students to learn C programming in order to do IoT? It's tough. C programming itself is so difficult. When you do pointers and you do pointers wrongly, you get a call dump or some weird things happening and all that. Pointers are not meant for, meant for people. It's very inhumane. So why don't we scratch that and do something else? I mean, there are higher level platforms. MicroPython, yes, is a good higher level platform. Even things like embedded JavaScript. But I realize that these things are a bit unreal. They're education oriented, but they're not meant for real world. The thing I passed around, SC Micro, it's got very little resources, 64K of ROM, 20K of RAM, very little resources, a bit like Apple II. It's so small that you cannot fit all these big things in. So how do you expect people to deploy MicroPython or JavaScript apps on these small devices? So you're wrong. The only thing that works for me so far is Rust. Rust is good because it's actually a low-level systems programming language. So the Mozilla web browser is done in Rust, right? So it's actually a good way to replace C. Through my experience, it actually replaces C quite well. The generated code is quite fast. ARM machine code, really well optimized. You can even interoperate between C and Rust. So my new API is done in C. I can easily call it from Rust, no problems, right? So and the best thing about it, pointers. Yes, they're pointers, but they're severely controlled. So they have what they call safety mechanisms. Instead of allowing your program to crash during runtime like C, they have a smart compiler. The compiler is really smart, okay? So smart that it detects that this guy is not supposed to use pointers and all that. It will actually stop you from compiling even.
What
okay?
language is the compiler written in?
I believe it's Rust itself. Right now it's all self-hosted. Yeah, so it's a really robust language. I think you should all use it. I mean, I don't understand why we are still doing pointers in this day. If you want to use pointers in Rust, you can. You use the unsafe keyword. But otherwise, Rust is a better alternative, right? So therefore, I got a few more resources down here that you can check about Rust. It's actually quite good. But Rust is actually quite hard to learn. Rust is a very deep, a theoretical foundation. In fact, if some of you know languages like Haskell, it actually comes from that kind of tradition. So it's very deep. That's why the compiler is so smart. In fact, the Rust compiler is so smart that sometimes I just find myself just fighting a compiler. compiler says no. So I had to keep fighting the compiler. But the good news is that once you fight the compiler, it runs without any problems. So my advice to you, do the easy stuff. There's a way to actually use Rust as though it were C. Okay? You can use pointers and all that, and safe code and all that. But eventually, when you learn more and more, you should just try and convert it to safe code, do it the right way. Okay? There are lots of features in Rust. Even I haven't mastered all the features yet. But eventually, you'll get to learn them. Right? And there's one thing I'm really quite interested in is that the Visual Rust. So if programming is so hard, why don't we have some kind of drag and drop kind of thing, like Scratch, On MicroBit, you can use Scratch to actually drag and drop to create your program. We can do it for Rust. And I actually got a prototype that you can see in my article. You can actually, in Visual Studio Code, just drag and drop blocks. And then the blocks will create Rust code for you. So even though, you know, if you don't understand Rust, well, look at the code it generates so you can see what's happening in there. And one day, if you look enough of it, then you can see how you, you know, you can actually customize the code yourself. So that's a good way to do Rust. So I'm really interested to develop this, but trouble is that, you know, I can't do this by myself. So anybody interested, we should try to do something together. Because I think Rust is a good way to get out of this whole thing with C. It's such an old language, we're still using it. I don't think we should continue using it anymore. We should move on. So let's start with Visual Rust, okay? So that's what I'm going on. Just a quick update on current projects. So now that I've done all these things, okay, now I'm trying to validate, you know, trying to apply all these things into new projects. Like for example, there's a smartwatch that I have at home. I didn't bring it here because it's kind of messy. So it's a smartwatch, looks like the Apple Watch, but it's actually built on NRF 5.2, the same one I'm passing around. And it's cheap, $22, right? Problem now is that it's lacking firmware. So that's why I'm helping them to build the firmware based on Minute and Rust. So one of these days, hopefully you can build your watch apps on Rust. Maybe you can use Visual Rust even to build the drag and drop and build watch apps. So we've got other ports in progress. Other people are doing TinyGo, okay, and another one doing Zephyr. Okay, so it's quite interesting that all these ports are going in parallel. And actually got a guy in Germany to help me to do an open source driver. So it's actually good that this open source thing is going on. Nordic NRF 5.2, I think it's also quite good. It's more expensive. So the Nordic NRF 5.2 costs $10 compared to $10 compared to Blue Pill, which is $3. But it's got extra stuff. You get 512KB flash ROM, you get 64KB RAM, and you get Bluetooth 5. But trouble is that it's not an ESP, so you cannot stop Wi-Fi, but what can you do with Bluetooth? Maybe you have a mesh or watches or something, I don't
it's
know.
It's ARM-based, right?
It's ARM-based, yeah. But the good thing about it is that it's actually it becomes irrelevant. Remember that we're using the RTOS now, Apache Minute. Minute will actually abstract all your APIs, I2C, SPI, everything. Okay. So the same code I tried on Blue Hill works exactly on Nordic NRF. In theory, it should also work on RISC-V, which I'm going to talk next. So RISC-V is actually an alternative to ARM. It's an open source, supposedly. It's very cheap. My RISC-V module is this guy here. So this is actually a RISC-V that I bought from the makers of the RISC-V chip gear device. Yeah. So RISC-V is actually a cheaper alternative. You know, there was this time where the trade war was going on between US and China. People were not sure whether China can still make ARM chips. Well, they came up with RISC-V. But then later on...
They probably never pay the royalty.
That's a funny issue. So that's the funny thing. So the one I'm passing around is actually G32 VF103. VF103 is quite interesting because it's actually quite similar to Blue Pill, which is F103. What they did was that they actually took the features of Blue Pill, which is STMicro, and they copied it into RISC-V. So it was quite interesting because you can see the reference sheets. It's actually quite similar, but not the same because there are different CPUs. But yet, you know, all the controllers are there, all the things are somewhat the same. But eventually, it got me very frustrated. I was trying to port my Nuke to RISC-V. Things are just too different. It's just too hard for me to do it. So, you know, I give up for now. It's tough. just a warning to you. So it's still too new, okay? So things are a bit rough. So if you want to do RISC-V, you know, do your own RISC, okay? I would suggest that why don't you just do ARM instead. Either ARM on STM32 or ARM on Nordic NRF. Yeah. Last thing, FPGA, okay? So I think we'll speak about FPGA here today also. I'm really excited about FPGA. It really gives you a different whole perspective on, you know, hardware and software. Because most of the time, your CPU is just busy doing looping around, waiting for nothing to do. Right? Instead of looping around, why don't you do something or busy or maybe go to sleep? Which is what FPGAs can do. It's very low level gates, connect them together so they can talk to your SPI control, talk to your SPI sensors, talk to your SPI transceivers. And then, you know, when there's nothing to do, just power down. So there's no need to actually keep looping around waiting for something to do. It's a lot more power efficient, okay? But trouble is that it's actually very, very hard to program. It's like going back to, you know, designing a CPU with all the gates and all that. It's beyond human capability. It's something that I can't manage. There's not even the proper programming language for that. It's very weird. It's true. I mean, it drove me crazy trying to figure out. Most of these are gadgets are actually made for, you know, like sequential code execution. FPGAs, well, everything happens all at once. It's like multitasking, you know, 100 times or 1,000 times. How do you manage all these things together? So I'm still, you know, I'm still hot on the idea, but I think we need better tools. So the Icebreaker is really good because it's open source tools. Let's move it a bit more and create something that we can easily understand. Like for example, I've got this SPI sensor, I've got this SPI transceiver. How do I translate it to actual gates I can use? You know, don't tell me to hook up individual gates, that's too much. So yeah, so that's one thing that I'm really look forward to. Okay, so yeah, sorry, run out of time already, but the respect the other speakers, I'll finish off for now. If you hang around here long enough, after the session, we'll talk more. I've got a lot of gadgets to give away. I'm not sure how we're going to spread out, but we're going to discuss afterwards. Yeah, so thank you.